Please rise in body or spirit as we join in our greeting and our opening hymn. Christ is risen. Please join now in singing Christ the Lord is Risen today on page 302 in the hymnal or on the screen. Hallelujah. You may be seated. The gospel reading this morning is from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 24. Very early in the morning, on the first day of the week, the women went to the tomb, bringing the fragrant spices they had prepared. They found the stone rolled away from the tomb. But when they went in, they didn't find the body of the Lord Jesus. They didn't know what to make of this. Suddenly, two men were standing beside them in gleaming bright clothing. The women were frightened and bowed their faces toward the ground. But the men said to them, "Why do you look for the living among the dead? He isn't here, but has been raised. Remember what he told you while he was still in Galilee? That the human one must be handed over to sinners, be crucified, and on the third day rise again." Then they remembered his words. When they returned from the tomb, they reported all these things to the 11 and all the others. It was Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary, the mother of James, and the other women with them who told these things to the apostles. Their words struck the apostles as nonsense, and they didn't believe the women. But Peter ran to the tomb. When he bent over to look inside, he saw only the linen cloth. Then he returned home, wondering what had happened. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. At this time, I would invite the children to come up for children's moments and to receive the pelican offering. During the month of March, this offering will be used for the Parsons Community Garden. So we gave the pelican a good breakfast this morning. That money that you put inside the pelican bird there is going to be used to help grow food in a garden so that people will have the good things to eat. So today is a very special day in the church. Who can tell me what day it is? Just shout it out.
Easter.
Easter. So on Easter Sunday, we are really joyful because something wonderful happened. Who remembers what happened on Good Friday, just a couple of days ago in the story? Carolyn? Who died? Jesus. So you remember, you read in the Bible the stories of Jesus, and it talks about how he was hung up on a cross. See the cross back there on the wall? Kind of looked like that. And that's where they put him, and that's where he died. And then they took his body off of the cross, and they put it in a place called a tomb. Who can tell me what a tomb is? I see a hand down here. McKenna? Yeah. Right. It's like a little cave. I wonder if you all can turn around where you are. And I'm going to ask Tanner if you would go up. I want you to show the kids how that under the altar there's a big stone and it rolls. Can you roll it down? Okay, that's what they did after Jesus died. They put his body inside the tomb, like a little carved out place in the stone, and they rolled that big stone across it so nobody could disturb it. Andrea?
It has to be round or else they would be able to move it.
Yeah, that's right, and it rolls, doesn't it? So Andrea, can you go up and show us what happened when the women went on Easter? They were going to take all these spices and things to put with the body, so it wouldn't smell bad because they knew Jesus had died. And turn around and look when she rolls the stone back. What do you see in there? Nothing. That's what happened when the women went to the tomb. Jesus wasn't there. Why wasn't Jesus there? Yeah. Sarah? He had risen. God raised him up from the dead. He wasn't dead anymore. He was alive. And so that means that when we believe in Jesus, we have the promise that we will live forever. Now, our bodies might wear out. They will wear out eventually. But what makes each of you special and unique, that lives on forever. Because you are a beloved child of God. And God loves us, and that's why God sent Jesus, so that we would know
God, and so we would know that we could have eternal life when we believe in Jesus. And that's the joy of Easter. You know, we say a word a lot on Easter Sunday. We say, Alleluia. Alleluia means praise God. And I want you to practice this sign with me from sign language, because the sign language for Alleluia is you clap your hands and then you circle your thumbs. It's like, whoa, thumbs up. This is good stuff, right? So say Alleluia with me while we do the sign. Alleluia. Amen. That is good news. Now I'm going to ask you to come and circle up. We'll have a prayer. And after the prayer, I have some books for each of you to take with you. And then also you'll want to pick up an activity bag, so you'll have some things to do during the rest of the service. So we're just going to circle up here. I'm going to come join us. You guys want to stay here for the prayer? Yeah. We'll let everybody in the circle. Mm-hmm. Got, yeah, you take an activity bag with you? Mm-hmm. All right. Say the words after me. Loving God.
Loving God.
Thank you for Jesus.
Thank you for Jesus.
Thank you for Easter.
Thank you for Easter.
So we know how much you love us.
Be with us this week.
And always. As we play, as we go to school, as we are with our families. We love you, God, and thank you for Jesus. Amen. Okay, now if you'll come and get a book and pick up a bag to use during the service. Okay? Yeah. Take one of these. It's the same thing that's in the carry bags. Okay?
Oh,
Thank you, choir and Janice. It's beautiful. In this day and age, we've learned to be skeptical and cynical. There's so much misinformation passed out on the internet and in the news sound bites that we're not sure what to believe. When Jesus is brought to trial before the Roman governor, Pilate asks Jesus, "What is truth?" Jesus doesn't answer. And we're still wrestling with that question today. What can we believe? Imagine that you're with the women who go to the tomb early in the morning. The sun is barely peeking through the trees. The grass is still heavy with dew. Your heart is filled with grief and anguish. On Friday, you stood near the cross, not too close because it was just too painful to watch. Your stomach clenched each time the crowd mocked Jesus, jeering and taunting him. The vision of his bruised and bleeding body is still burned into your brain. At noon, the sky got dark, cast a threatening gloom over everything. It lasted until 3:00. The atmosphere was thick with foreboding. Finally, as Jesus drew his last breath, he says, "It is finished." Jesus died. End of story. But wait, there's more. The worst thing is not the last thing. This morning you've come to the garden where they laid Jesus' body in the tomb. Because Jesus died near sundown on Friday at the beginning of the Jewish Sabbath, there wasn't sufficient time to prepare the body for burial. His body was hastily wrapped in burial cloths before the stone was rolled across the opening and sealed. Then everyone went home to observe the Sabbath. Now the Sabbath is over, and the women quietly enter the garden bearing fragrant spices for the body. You can smell the frankincense and myrrh wafting through the air. But what's this? The stone is rolled back. Hesitantly, you follow the women into the small space carved out for the tomb. And the tomb is empty. The body is gone. What happened? Suddenly, you're startled when two men in dazzling clothes appear. Everyone's frightened and bows down. Who are these men that inspire such fear and awe? The men chastise the group, saying, "Why do you look for the living among the dead?" They remind you what Jesus said earlier when you were together in Galilee, that the Son of Man must be crucified and rise up on the third day. Do you believe what they're telling you? When we struggle to believe this amazing story, we remember that the apostles didn't believe it at first either. The women return to the room where the 11 disciples and many other disciples are gathered and report what happened. And it says the apostles thought it was nonsense. They didn't believe. Some of us have had that same experience. We go and tell somebody and report what we've seen and what we've heard with our own eyes and ears, and they don't believe us. It's really frustrating. What does it take for us to believe that Jesus was raised from the dead? We might be more convinced if we can find multiple sources telling the same story. We have four different accounts of this event told in the Bible in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. There are some slight variations, yet all four of the Gospels indicate that at first no one believed that Jesus had risen from the dead. In the original ending to the Gospel of Mark, the women are so overcome with terror and dread, they fled from the tomb. They said nothing to anyone because they were afraid. What do you suppose they were afraid of? Well, if I were there, I might be afraid I'd be labeled as being crazy or hysterical. Maybe they were afraid they would be accused of colluding with others to steal the body from the tomb and hide it. If you were they, how would you feel? Listen to these words of Matthew chapter 28. Now, as the women were on their way, some of the guards came into the city and told the chief priests everything that had happened. The chief priests met with the elders and decided to give a large sum of money to the soldiers. They told them, "Say that Jesus' disciples came at night and stole his body while you were sleeping. And if the governor hears about this, we will take care of it with him, so you will have nothing to worry about." So the soldiers took the money and did as they were told. And this report has spread throughout all Judea to this very day. This was an attempt to discredit the resurrection story by floating out there a conspiracy theory. It reminds me of the stories that continue to crop up about man landing on the moon on July 20th, 1969. I'm old enough to remember as a child watching that on the old black and white TV in the basement rec room. And yet there are still some people today who will claim that it was all done on a soundstage in Hollywood, that it didn't really happen. When is something a hoax and when is it real? Who can we trust and what do we believe? If we investigate scripture some more, we find different accounts of how and when the disciples believe Jesus is really alive. The first disciple to believe is Mary Magdalene. In the account written in the Gospel of John, she sees Jesus in the garden of the tomb, and at first she thinks he's the gardener. But when he calls her by name, Mary, she suddenly understands and sees Jesus standing in front of her. What has happened is still a mystery. She doesn't know how God has raised Jesus from the dead, but now she believes it really happened. And in our communion liturgy, each time we say it, we reflect that same thought as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ has risen. Christ will come again. The Gospel of Luke tells the story of two disciples walking on the road to Emmaus on that same Sunday. They were in Jerusalem that morning. They heard the reports from the women, but they didn't believe it was real. Jesus comes along beside the two of them, and they don't recognize him at first. It's only when they arrive at home and invite him in to eat supper with them that suddenly their eyes are opened. It's when he breaks the bread, and then they know it is Jesus who is with them. His actions recall the memory of that last meal and reveal his identity, just as we can feel Christ's presence with us each time we take communion and break the bread. In the Gospel of John, Jesus appears to the disciples who are locked in an upstairs room. They're grieving the loss of their leader and wondering, what should they do next? What's going to happen? They're afraid that any moment they might be arrested, taken away, and suffer the same fate as Jesus. And suddenly Jesus appears in the room and speaks with them. He returns again days later, and Thomas, who was missing from that first encounter, sees for himself that Jesus is truly alive. Jesus appears on the beach when the disciples are out fishing, and he prepares a fire and broils fish to eat with them over breakfast. This is certainly not something a ghost would be doing, eating food. In the book of Acts, it says that over a period of 40 days, he presented himself alive to them with many convincing proofs, speaking of the kingdom of God. For those skeptics who like to have lots of evidence, the scriptures provide plenty of accounts to support the claim that Jesus has been raised from the dead. There are others who come to believe in other ways. They hear the stories of Jesus, his life, death, and resurrection. They remember what Jesus said and did, and they find truth in his teachings, He's fulfilled the prophecies in the scriptures of the Old Testament. So Jesus confirms their beliefs and expectations. Others feel it in their hearts. Theirs is a leap of faith. They look at the evidence, they read scripture, but in the end, they simply accept that Jesus is truly the Messiah, sent from God to reveal God to us. Jesus consistently points us to God's glory. Jesus did not raise himself from the dead. God raised him up. Jesus did not call upon his divine powers to save himself from the cross. He suffered and died a human death. There was no miraculous last-minute reprieve from the horrors of crucifixion. The miracle came not in being saved from death, but embracing death to move into eternal life. This is the same miracle that can happen in each of us when we come to believe in Jesus, the Son of God, the one who loves us so much that he is willing to die for us. Our old life is put to death at the moment we believe. We drop our heavy burdens of past wrongs we've committed. We let go of our fears of living in a world full of cruelty and disappointment and corruption. We stop living only for ourselves, asking, "What's in it for me?" Our old lives are left behind in the empty tomb. We step out with faith, resurrected from our old life to a new life with Jesus. But each of us must decide for ourselves, what do we believe? Just as the early followers of Jesus were perplexed, filled with fear and doubts, and had to come to their own conclusions, Christians today also need to ask ourselves, what do we believe? You may have a steadfast and firm answer to that question. Or maybe you're still asking questions, searching out answers, and forming your Christian faith. We're not so different from those first disciples of Jesus. Can we hear Jesus calling our name as Mary Magdalene did? Can we sense that Jesus is walking beside us down the roads of life? When the disciple Thomas sees the wounds on Jesus' body, he finally believes as he exclaims, "My Lord and my God." And Jesus says, "Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have come to believe." He's speaking to us 2,000 years later, to all the generations that came after who believe. Today we come to church to celebrate the joy of resurrection, to renew our faith in the promise that God loves us so much that God gave his only Son, so that whoever believes in him will not die, but will have eternal life. May we be blessed as we come to believe in Jesus Christ, our risen Lord and Savior. Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. Alleluia. Please join now in our hymn of response, "You Alone Are Holy," found in the Faith We Sing on page 2077 or on the screen.
Splendor, and with all so much.
It was a tradition from the very beginning in the early church that those who were joining the church would do so on Easter Sunday. So I'm pleased this morning to ask Deborah Foster to come up along with Trent and Mallory Harris and any others that are coming with you. If you will turn in your hymnal to page 38, you will be able to follow along with this service. This morning, Deborah Foster comes to us from Southside Baptist Church in Perryton, Texas. And so, Deborah, as you join the United Methodist Church, I ask you, as a member of Christ's Universal Church, will you be loyal to the United Methodist Church and do all in your power to strengthen its ministries? And then we have also Trent and Mallory who are joining us. Mallory comes to us from Winter United Methodist Church in Winter, South Dakota. And Trent Harris comes to us from the Methodist Church in Valentine, Nebraska. And so I ask all three of you, as members of this congregation, will you faithfully participate in its ministries by your prayers, your presence, your gifts, your service, and your witness? Members of the household of God, I commend these persons to your love and care. Do all in your power to increase their faith, confirm their hope, and perfect them in love.
We give thanks for all that God has already given you, and we welcome you in Christian love, as members together with you in the body of Christ and in this congregation of the United Methodist Church. We renew our covenant.
The God of all grace, who has called us to eternal glory in Christ, establish you and strengthen you by the power of the Holy Spirit, that you may live in grace and peace. Deborah, welcome you to Wesley United Methodist. Certificate of membership. Mallory, I'll give you the right hand of fellowship as we welcome you into Wesley United Methodist. And Trent, welcome. We're glad you're here. Let's welcome them with applause. And I would ask you to join me out in the hall outside the sanctuary following the service so people might greet you, and then we'll get your picture before you leave. It is a joy to have new members in our family of faith. At this time, I invite you to be in an attitude of prayer. God of power and majesty, with the rising of the sun, you have raised Jesus Christ and delivered him and us from death's destruction. We praise you on this bright day for all your gifts of new life. Especially we thank you for all victories over sin and evil in our lives. For loyalty and love of friends and family. For the newborn, the newly baptized, and those now in your eternal home. For the renewal of nature. For the continuing witness of the Church of Christ. God of eternity, you are present with us because of Christ rising from the dead, and you persist in lifting us to new life in him. We bring to you our prayers for this world in need of resurrection. Especially we pray for nations and peoples in strife. For the poor and impoverished at home and abroad. For those we know in particular circumstances of distress. For those fighting disease and those who are dying. For all who follow the risen Christ. Through the same Jesus Christ, our Lord, who taught his disciples to pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. At this time, we can respond to the good news of Jesus Christ for all that God has done for us by giving our tithes, our gifts, and our offerings. And today's Easter offering will be sent to Camp Chippewa to help with the ongoing needs of the camp.
Thank you.
God, we lift up our hearts to you, our hearts that are overflowing with gratitude for all that you have done for us. And God, we give you praise and thanks for the greatest gift of all, your Son, Jesus. And so we bring you these gifts that they might be used for your glory here on earth as we spread the good news of Jesus Christ throughout the land. Amen. I would invite those of you who would like to join the choir for the Hallelujah Chorus to please come up now as we sing our closing hymn. I know you're out there, folks who enjoy singing, and we have extra music, so please come up and join us. That will be our postlude for this morning. And now, those of you in the pews, if you will turn to Christ is Alive, either on the screen or page 318.
Let streets and Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.